In the U.S., only behind the National Press Club in D.C. We offer unique opportunities for journalists, such as tonight's event. We do things for the community. We have newsmaker events. And what we want to do is bring together the city and have the conversation about what everybody's concerned about. I want to personally thank you all for coming. You're here because you care about journalism and you care about journalists. And if there's ever a time when we need journalism, it's right now.
It is truly an honor in seeing this event tonight and being here with so many fabulous, wonderful people. The Atlanta Press Club Hall of Fame recognizes journalists whose impact on Atlanta and the country will definitely be felt forever. Our first inductee made his mark as Atlanta's longest-serving news director, spending more than 20 years at WAGA-TV. Ladies and gentlemen, look at the video screens, Mr. Bud McEntee.
Saw him on the air, never heard his voice.
And I'm Spencer, first on Fox 5 tonight.
But for nearly 30 years, you watched the newscast of WAGA-TV Atlanta.
If you want to experience the story, be part of it.
You were watching Bud McEntee.
Your world from every angle.
His imprint.
If you want to see all sides of the news.
Bud McEntee's newscast on WAGA, beginning in 1982, as a news producer and managing editor, and then as news director from 1991 to 2010, earned every major journalism award multiple times. They were newscasts put together day and night by teams of journalists who were hired and who were led by the sometimes smiling and always hard-charging, uncompromising, laser-focused Bud McEntee.
As a news director, the cliche comes to mind of Lou Grant, for those of you who remember that television program. He was old-fashioned, he was old-school, he was all about getting it done quickly and accurately, and he was a stickler for accuracy and facts. He was a very hands-on news director. We're going to try to break down this ballot for you.
Dick Williams, the moderator of the weekly Georgia Gang political debate on WAGA, joined the program about the time McEntee became news director. And McEntee would watch all the evening newscast at once, demanding, of course, no less of his journalists than that they meet the others on every story, every day.
He was the last of the news directors who would come out of his office shouting at something he saw on television or something he saw happening that he didn't like. You gotta look at McEntee as a guy who stuck to his knitting, kept his integrity, protected his staff, and always was in search of better stories.
And McEntee was protecting his staff through more than one unexpected change in a tumultuous industry.
The 45-year relationship between WAGA-TV, Channel 5, and CBS is over.
In 1994, WAGA's parent company dropped a bombshell on everyone at the station by dropping CBS and its global news gathering operation and replacing it with Fox. Fox, back then, had The Simpsons. There's no Fox News Channel. Not yet.
It's 6 a.m., and this is Good Day Atlanta.
McEntee saw it as a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for his journalists. He took control of Channel 5's new, valuable airtime.
From 4:30 to 10 a.m. on Fox 5.
And ultimately, McEntee was able to triple his local newscast to nearly 60 hours a week, more than any other station in the market. And viewers stayed with WAGA.
There's still a great thirst for local news.
That's McEntee speaking at an Atlanta Press Club forum in 2009, insisting that the challenge wasn't to fill the extra quantity of airtime, but to fill it with consistent quality. His pride and joy?
It's only five words. Five words that strike fear in corrupt politicians.
The nationally renowned I-teams.
Five words that make the difference between ripoffs and reform.
I'm with the I-team.
Dedicated, determined, and dependable.
Good evening, I'm Brenda Wood.
And I'm John Marler. We begin tonight with the results of a three-month I-team investigation.
There was a time when corporate budget cutters, prior to Fox, targeted the I-team. McEntee told the story at the same press club forum in 2009, the year before he retired from WAGA.
There was a recommendation that we scale down investigative reporting, and I fought hard along with a couple of other folks, and instead of scaling back, we expanded the I-team.
McEntee never said whether corporate owners ever again tried to scale back the I-team. His pride and joy thrives.
The muscle is here now, and things not exactly as they seemed here.
No, sir, they're not.
McEntee nurtured generations of young journalists to become story-breaking veterans who stayed with McEntee and WAGA most of their careers.
McEntee had been there so long, he really knew his turf. And he kept his people for long periods of time, so that institutional memory was always there.
I mean, the average lifespan for a news director is somewhere between 2 years and 2.5 years. So 20 years is way beyond meeting the odds. It's sort of like living to 150 years. You know, people just don't do it. So it says a lot to him about Bud and his qualities.
Monday 11 on CBS 46 News.
Mark Pimentel is the vice president and general manager of Atlanta's CBS 46. And he and McEntee have worked with and competed against each other since their first jobs in TV news.
At his core, he is a true newsman. He understands good journalism, good storytelling. He was a great judge of talent. He hired some great people.
Fox 5 News at 6.
And Pimentel points out that to this day, you can still see Bud McEntee, the McEntee legacy, on every newscast.
He built the foundation of what they are today in terms of news product. Whoever has come behind him has built on that. But without the foundation that Bud had laid, they wouldn't be where they are today.
Bud McEntee, inducted into the 2016 Atlanta Press Club Hall of Fame.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to our investigative panel of 2013 Hall of Fame inductee, Dale Russell.
Well, that pretty much said everything I wanted to say. It is really an exciting moment to me to be in this room with so many journalists whose work that I observe and enjoy, both my coworkers and competitors. And this time and era that we're talking about, where we're all under so much duress for what we do, it's great to see this room full of people that just get up and go to work every day and try to get it right. And the guy who led us on that trek at Fox 5 and WAGA before that was my man, Bud. And if I can borrow from Shakespeare, Bud, we're here to praise you, not to bury you. There's so much I can say about this man because I worked in every second of his 19 years as a news director at WAGA. But I'm not going to go on and on and on because Bud will go on and on and on once he gets up here. But I want to tell you that my basic nature is to research a topic, even though it's one I well know. So I sent out an email message to all my Fox 5 friends to ask some Bud up for me in one word. If you need a couple words, if you could. And this is what I got back. Passion, competitive, fierce, loyal, competitive, caring. And I'll explain that later. Competitive, did I say competitive? Lucky, and this was in total deference to the fact that he's married to one of God's greatest women on this planet, Annette, and his two wonderful children who are here tonight, David and Anna. Old school, always had your back when fight the suits for you. And as Randy Travis says, a dedicated, determined, and dependable stick of dynamite. And my favorite, an angry red-faced Irishman. Bud came into the newsroom every day, very simply, with one mantra. Win. We're going to win. We're going to tell better stories. We're going to tell more stories. We're going to break stories that nobody else has. And we're going to do them in a way that nobody else is going to do. And that was what we all lived under every day. It wasn't always easy. He set a very high bar for all of us and asked everyone, no, let me rephrase that, demanded that everyone jump that bar every day. I think one of my favorite moments with Bud, and I use this euphemistically, was 5 o'clock one day in an afternoon, we got beat on a story by WSB, and Bud came out of that room screaming and yelling. The IT office was down below, we're in another floor. I got called up, and they said, he basically called me in and said, fix it. And it was one of those days, as you all know, you're on the mountaintop of journalism one day, and you're on the valley the very next. And this was one of those valley days. And I had an hour and got it all together and somehow pulled something off and got the facts and got everything we needed to get back off, lead the six, and kind of get us back up on the same playing field. And I walked out of there, office set, kind of thumping my chest, you know, I did good. Took one for the team, brought us back, we're in play now, this is good. Came around the corner. There's that angry face. Red angry-faced Irishman, and I looked up at him feeling really good about myself, and he said, what do you have for 10? I thought, I barely know what I've been on the air with 6. But I worked till 10, because that's what you did when you worked in Bud McEntee's newsroom. Old school, yes, but I've always said, and they referenced in this, new wave in so many ways, because when so many companies, so many corporations throughout America were cutting back on investigative reporting, Bud not only didn't cut back, refused to accept cutbacks, but made it grow. It made it bigger. And took what at the time, with our executive producer, Michael Carlin, and me, Virginia Ellis, and expanded into an 8-person unit. 3 reporters, Randy Travis joined us, 2 photographers, a producer, an executive producer, and a dedicated editor, and we've stayed that way ever since. And he was doing that in the 90s, when nobody was doing that. And he pushed us as hard as he pushed the rest of the newsroom. It was, as I said, never easy in a Bud McEntee newsroom. But the word that I heard from one of the co-workers, Ms. Kisak, who said caring, and she said, Bud cared about the news and he cared about the people. And if I've heard it once, I've heard it 100 times, at a retirement, when somebody was leaving us, when somebody unfortunately had passed away in the family, that Bud would get up in front of everyone with Channel 5 and tell them that I know that they have a 5 right here implanted on their heart. And that's how he felt. As hard as he pushed us, he loved us just as much. And that's why I love this man, Bud McEntee.
Thank members of the Atlanta Press Club for hosting tonight and this great one. In particular, he's having a great conversation with Tom Johnson. And he and I got hoodwinked into the Atlanta Press Club by the same two women. And they're both here tonight, so I get to call them out. My former friends, Maria Saporta and Karen Greer. In 1995, came to me and said, "Would you like to be on the Press Club board?" I said, "Sure, fine, that's great." About a day later, said, "We'd like to become president of the Atlanta Press Club." I remember going back to a fellow who was my boss at the time, and I said, "Jack, they want me to become the president of the Atlanta Press Club." He said, "Good, you can do that on your own time." I said, "Whoa, they're going to help me out." Well, thank God they did. And it was one of the greatest experiences that I ever had. Because I got to meet journalists from print, radio, and television, who came through this town and did a fantastic job, and to this day, do a fantastic job. And, sidebar, like Tom, I got to know some of the fine folks at the time at CNN, including my close friend, Jack Holbein. You know, growing up in Queens, New York, I never imagined that I would not only call Atlanta home, but how much I would grow to love it here. I fell in love with the South when I met the love of my wife, life, or my wife, Nanette. And we met in Nashville, Tennessee. I was actually hired at WKRN by this gorgeous woman, who had become my wife, my best friend, and mother, David and Anna. And Ed was the director of human resources at WKRN, which is, then was WNGE. And I remember receiving the acceptance letter from the TV station by somebody named Nanette. Little did I know, that letter would turn out to be the love letter of a lifetime. You are my heart. Well, we left Nashville, and we were bound for St. Louis. And something funny happened on the way to St. Louis. I was going to go work for KMOV. Back then, KMOX, CBS owned and operated station. And I was going to be the 5 o'clock producer. So we were all ready to go. When I got a phone call from the very man who recommended me for the job in St. Louis, and he said, "I need you here in Atlanta." My wife, being from Birmingham, was very pro-Atlanta. Nothing disparaging about St. Louis. Great baseball town. In any case, we ended up here in Atlanta. Funny sidebar, after I had to call the executive producer in St. Louis to tell her I was not coming, I didn't know that this was the woman's first hire ever. And I'll never forget dead silence on the phone. And I had been told by the person who arranged this switch that everything was fine. Everybody at CBS knew, except her. So there I am on the phone, and I'm apologizing, saying it would have been really nice to work in St. Louis, and I'm sorry. And she said, "Bud McEntee, I'm going to tell you something right now. You will never work for CBS News. As a matter of fact, everyone's going to know this, including Mr. Cronkite." Now, I was 26 years old. I'm happy to say, sidebar, that I met Walter Cronkite the same time I met Judy Woodruff years ago at an RTMDA. Judy was gracious, as always, and so was Mr. Cronkite. He never mentioned a thing about it. I started as the 11 o'clock producer. I wrapped up a fantastic career at WAGA 30 years later. From the very first day, I was surrounded by some of the best journalists and teachers in the country. I am so thankful to the many outstanding journalists, and I use that word with a capital J. It taught me the right, fair, and balanced way to tell stories objectively, without slant or bias. I've always said that WAGA, Channel 5, TV 5, Eyewitness News, 5 News Scene, whatever you call it, we were fair and balanced before fair and balanced was cool. During my 30 years at WAGA, you saw in the terrific video, and I'm so appreciative of that, I lived through a lot of changes. I used to say I was the news director at 3 television stations in 1. A strong CBS affiliate, a strong Fox affiliate, and a strong Fox-owned and operated station. At the time, general manager Jack Sander took a crazy leap and promoted me to be news director. And as I say, we were among the elite CBS affiliates. And then just as I was feeling comfortable, bam, as my daughter would say, we switched from CBS to Fox. We were a bit nervous. Our competitors were dancing down Peachtree. The death of WAGA. We were WAGA. CBS or Fox, it didn't matter. In fact, that switch was probably one of the best things that happened. We grew in ratings, revenue, number of locally produced newscasts. That growth continued when we became a Fox-owned and operated station. One of the people greatly responsible for that growth is with us tonight, my former GM and friend, Gene McHugh. Gene and I have often said we worked with some of the best in what we call a golden time in local television. I'm very proud of what we as a team accomplished, including the creation of Good Day Atlanta, which now is probably, what, All Day Atlanta? Fox 5 News at 10, Fox 5 News Edge at 11. And not just because Dale Russell introduced me. I am particularly proud of WAGA's commitment to investigative reporting. And as Dale alluded, it was suggested when I first became news director that we follow a cost-cutting pattern taken by many local newsrooms, scale back or eliminate investigative reporting. Needless to say, we took a different path. I believe then, as I do now, that investigative reporting, especially at the local level, is critical to the success and growth of journalism. Whether on local broadcasts, websites, or social media. Investigative is the lifeblood of what we do, and true investigative is more relevant than ever before. I thank those who supported what was called by some my crazy decision to not just maintain the I-Team, but rather develop and expand our investigative efforts, so as to provide true and unique life-changing reporting that affects all of us. To that end, forgive me if I miss somebody. I salute Dale, Michael, Randy, Travis, Randy Travis and Travis Shields, and Mindy Lorton, and all who were part of the I-Team and who are part of the I-Team now. And I salute all investigative reporters, including my friend Richard Belcher and Karen Greer, from all around the country, for your commitment to digging into issues that affect the lives of so many and by telling stories that truly matter. Remember, news consumers can get the basic news of the day from a variety of sources in 2016. They've already checked their cell phones and Facebook before they turn on the local morning news. But what they can't get is your uniquely produced local investigative stories stories that set you apart. I am proud of the team that I helped build and the work family that I've been fortunate enough to call friends over the last 3 decades. Together, we have witnessed so many changes in this news business, but I think the fundamentals of the game are still the same. Now more than ever, in our nation, as journalists, and therefore the historians of our time, it is so important for a free press. As journalists, we have the opportunity, moreover, the obligation to ask meaningful questions of decision makers. And I encourage all to explore the how and the why. How did it happen? And why did it happen? What do we learn from it? What matters is that we produce to the best of our abilities. We commit to great storytelling with unique content. We need to be tough and relentless in our search for truth. People rely upon us to dig deeper and ask the questions they wish they could ask. I guess my stories have been around a little bit, Dale. You're right. When I served as the news director at WAGA, inevitably, somebody would come into my office, interrupt my seventh Diet Coke of the day, tell me they were heading off to a new opportunity. And I would always remind them of what a special place WAGA was, and I hope WAGA will be forever. I would tell them as a result of that experience, he or she would forever have that little five carved in their heart. And that goes double for me. I'll always have that little five carved in my heart. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for this great honor.
And now Bud putting his mark on WGCL. We thank you. Where's all the WAGA family? Please stand up really quickly as we move on to the next honorary WAGA. Fox 5. Whatever you prefer to be called. And that concludes tonight's ceremony. Thank you again to all of our wonderful sponsors on behalf of the Atlanta Press Club. Thank you for attending this Hall of Fame dinner. Have a great evening. Stay safe. Thank you.